Where is James Webb now? Good news from the telescope. The James Webb telescope has lifted off. After three postponements in the last 10 days and more than two decades of waiting, on December 25th at 12:20 p.m. Universal Time, the largest and most complex space telescope ever built lifted off from the launch pad in Kourou, French Guiana, propelled beyond the atmosphere by a powerful and reliable Ariane 5 rocket. At this moment, it's already on its way to its operational destination, the Lagrangian point L2, 1.5 million kilometers from Earth. And when you guys listen to these words of mine, probably the first days of January, Webb will have already completed the deployment of the Big Sunshield, one of the most complex and dangerous operations. The Webb telescope, in fact, has passed unscathed the Russian roulette of the launch, but in front of it still has a long journey full of pitfalls, which in the next 6 months could endanger the success of the mission at any stage. It's incalculable the number of times we have talked about the infamous James Webb Space Telescope. Its birth and deployment have been incredibly troubled, and it took more than 10 years to bring it to completion. These problems have been discussed enough, but now, as many of you know, it's right to give space to the good news. The Webb Telescope has started. A wonderful Christmas present for the many fans of space and astronomy. And not only that, on December 29th, the day Webb also passed the moon's orbit, NASA announced that Ariane had performed so well during the launch that the telescope now has much more fuel available than we'd hoped for. In fact, Ariane was so precise in drawing Webb's trajectory to the Lagrangian L2 point that further future course corrections are unnecessary. The fuel on board the telescope is a surplus compared to the operational autonomy guaranteed by the solar panels. But its excess availability will allow useful operations to ensure the survival of the project for longer, deeper, and more ambitious studies than the team could hope for before the Christmas launch. Before, a duration of 5 years was prudently assumed. Now we have moved to 10 or 15 years. A huge step forward. The idea of sending such a large telescope into space began to circulate among astronomers and NASA in the 1990s, shortly after the launch of the Hubble Space Telescope, which in a 30-year career has made countless observations and discoveries about stars, galaxies, nebulae, and black holes. Hubble was the best demonstration of the possibility of building an observatory in orbit, excluding the distortions caused by the Earth's atmosphere that often complicate life for telescopes here on Earth, and also to protect our atmosphere so that climate change is contained and the possibility of observing the starry night sky even with the naked eye, that I would like to introduce today's sponsor, REN. The current levels of CO2 in our atmosphere are extremely worrying. According to recent studies, it has reached the highest values in human history, and each of us contributes to these emissions. REN's mission is to help each and every one of us become free from harmful emissions, and they do it in a very ingenious way. On the REN website, you will find a calculator where you can calculate your carbon footprint, then offset it by funding a diverse mix of carbon reduction projects like tree planting, mineral weathering, and rainforest protection. By subscribing to one of the proposed subscriptions, you can decide the percentage of environmental impact you will have towards the environment, receiving monthly testimonials on how your money is spent through photos of each tree planted, every acre reforested, every ton of carbon offset. Visit REN from the link that you will find between comments and description. The first 100 people who sign up will have 10 extra trees planted in their name. If it was possible to do this with an instrument equipped with a 2.4-meter diameter mirror, then it was a good chance that even larger telescopes could be built and taken into orbit, astronomers and engineers thought. So much so that a committee was set up to explore the possibility of building a large, next-generation telescope, capable of observing celestial bodies billions of light-years away. Among the first to take shape during the turbulent formation of the universe some 13.8 billion years ago. Early proposals were for a telescope with a diameter of 4 meters, slightly less than twice the size of Hubble, and with instruments calibrated to make infrared observations. The whole initiative would have cost about $1 billion and would have required a relatively short time to be realized. At least that's what was thought. The administrator of NASA, Dan Golden, expressed the interest of the U.S. Space Agency for the project and even said that the thing would make sense only by making a telescope with a much larger mirror, 8 meters in diameter. It's kind of what's going on nowadays with the Lorenzovareseaziendale Space Telescope project, which is not yet known if it will be 8 or 15 meters in diameter. The announcement was greeted with great interest by the astronomical community, but it was also the starting point of one of the most difficult, troubled, and expensive projects in recent NASA history. The very ambitious plan was later revised, arriving at the compromise of a mirror of 6.5 meters that would not be possible to bring it to orbit already open, because of the space offered by any rocket. It was therefore necessary to think of a system never experienced before, and that together with other changes to the project determined a considerable increase in the cost of implementation. The delivery date was postponed several times due to technical problems, mostly due to the need to develop completely new and unexplored technological solutions. NASA assumed to have Webb ready for the end of 2011, spending a total of about $5 billion. But the delays accumulated, so that at some point the U.S. Congress considered the possibility of stopping the project, but it was now too advanced to be stopped. In the end, 25 years were needed to design and finish the telescope, with an expenditure of more than $10 billion. That seems a lot, but nothing compared to the $2 trillion that only in 2020 were spent in the world for armaments. What do you guys think? Okay, let us put the controversy aside and return to the current news. It seems that after the launch, everything is going as the most optimistic forecasts expected. The flow of data between the control center and the telescope has already begun, and in the meantime, the solar panels have been deployed according to schedule, and has also begun the more complex deployment of the sunshield. And now, what happens? The next step will be to allow the full deployment of the sunshield, a very complicated and delicate process, in which 140 release mechanisms, 70 hinges, 400 rollers, 90 cables, and 8 motors must interlock and all function properly. The last step to installing the parasol will be to correctly tensify its 5 membranes. If nothing goes wrong, about 12 to 13 days after launch on January 6th or 7th, the wings on both sides of the mirror will extend and lock into place, creating a full-size surface. All segments of primary and secondary mirrors will be unlocked and their mobility controlled. The secondary mirror of the telescope, placed at the end of 3 long arms, is lowered in position. Despite its name, the secondary mirror is a critical component to Webb's success. If other parts of the telescope do not work perfectly, there may be solutions. But if the secondary mirror is not deployed successfully, there will be nothing more to do. Towards the end of the first month of the mission, the final intermediate maneuver will take place to reach the optimum orbit around L2. This maneuver, as NASA has announced, will perhaps not be necessary. During this period, the scientific instruments on board will also be activated. The remaining 5 months of commissioning will focus on optical alignment and calibration of the coronagraph instruments, spectrograph, and imaging chambers. A month after launch, Webb should finally reach L2, completing one of the boldest space flights ever and allowing astronomers around the world to breathe a collective sigh of relief. In the second, third, and fourth months, Webb will attempt to point a single bright star and demonstrate that the observatory can acquire and engage targets. But since the segments of the primary mirror have yet to be aligned to function as a single mirror, up to 18 distinct images of the same star will occur on the focal plane. The process of aligning the individual mirrors will last at least a couple of months and will end only when each of them focuses the image of the star in a single point. In the fifth and sixth months, all the operating modes of scientific instruments will be meticulously calibrated, observing representative targets and the ability to follow moving targets such as asteroids, comets, moons, and planets in our solar system will be established. This will be followed by a phase called early release observations, which will illustrate the imaging capabilities of the observatory. After 6 months, Webb will begin its scientific mission and begin conducting routine scientific operations. 5 more months or so will be devoted to early release scientific observations. Selected astronomers will train the telescope on a wide range of targets, from distant galaxies to planets in our solar system, to gain experience with the features of this new instrument and share that knowledge with the rest of the astronomical community. Other astronomers will take precedence over the so-called time-guaranteed observatories, people who have spent years of their lives designing and building this telescope and will therefore have the first opportunity to use it without having to compete for observation time. Webb is essentially an infrared telescope, a space observatory that will play a key role in various areas of astronomical research in the near future. But what exactly does infrared astronomy mean? Quite simply, it means that Webb will be able to see beyond the visible spectrum at wavelengths of light longer than those to which our eyes are accustomed. The advantage? To take a trivial example, if the sky near the horizon appears red to us at sunset and sunrise, it's only because the infrared light, with its long separation, can more easily scan the dust grains in the lower atmosphere and then reach our eyes to a greater extent than the light of shorter wavelengths. Similarly, the James Webb Space Telescope will be able to reveal what's happening inside clusters of gas and dust that are opaque to visible light and therefore inaccessible even to large optical telescopes from the ground. In addition, for a variety of reasons, the light from the most distant objects undergoes a stretching effect towards the red, causing the light itself to move from the visible to the infrared. This means that observing these very distant objects, such as the first galaxies to form in the universe, requires a telescope that specializes in infrared observation, such as the Webb. To see infrared light, however, the Webb must shield both the heat of the sun and that of its own instruments. The first line of defense is a 5-layer solar shield that will keep the telescope cool at minus 233 degrees Celsius, but even a solar shield isn't enough. Webb must also avoid thermal interference from Earth and the Moon. That explains why the telescope is flying into a small region of space called L2, which is 1.5 million kilometers from Earth and 1.1 million kilometers from the Moon. There, the Sun's and Earth's gravity balance each other in a way that allows Webb to keep the Sun, Earth, and Moon permanently behind the sunshield while it observes the cosmos ahead. The problem with this solution is that there's no way to intervene in the telescope if problems arise. No manned spacecraft could reach it, except for the wonders of SpaceX with its revolutionary Starship. In recent years, Hubble has been able to identify galaxies formed just 400 million years after the Big Bang. NASA and other research organizations hope we can reach 100 million years with the new telescope. Observing galaxies that old could be the way to understand how today's galaxies formed and why they have supermassive black holes at their centers, with masses billions of times that of our Sun. Webb can also be used to determine more precisely the rate at which the universe is expanding. The problem has been discussed for years. It seems to be almost solved thanks to the data collected by Hubble. And not only that, other elements have emerged that have challenged some of the original assumptions. The determination of the expansion rate is essential to correctly calculate the distance between galaxies and, more generally, the evolution of the universe. But there's something else that the James Webb Telescope can help us explore, in an area of astronomy that was fringe when construction began and now is one of the most interesting and vibrant, the exploration and especially the study of the atmospheres of extrasolar planets. For millennia, mankind has pondered the questions: are we alone? What's life? Is there life elsewhere that's similar to us? And today, for the first time, we have the scientific knowledge and technological capabilities to realistically begin to find the answers to these questions. Webb will be able to directly detect many new planets, especially in the gas giant category. But most importantly, the hope is that its extraordinary spectrographs will be able to probe the atmospheres of Earth-like planets located in what's known as the habitability belt. The telescope is equipped with a coronagraph that allows direct imaging of planets near very bright stars. The planet will appear as a bright, seemingly insignificant dot. In fact, we can derive very important information from this point using spectroscopy. Even if an exoplanet appears just as a single pixel, that point of light would change in important ways over time. With enough data, we can determine how fast the planet rotates on its axis, whether it's fully or partially cloudy, and how those clouds are composed, whether there are fluids, continents, and oceans, and what portion of them is covered with water, whether there are polar ice caps, and whether the colors of the continents change with the seasons. By observing the planet as it moves along its star's disk, Webb will also be able to look for chemical biomarkers in the atmosphere such as oxygen, ozone, and methane, possible indicators of the presence of at least elemental life. In short, with Webb, the prospects for a future full of surprises are incredibly exciting. A quarter century ago, the existence of exoplanets was a subject for science fiction movies, and today we know of nearly 5,000. And to know that a powerful space machine sent by us Earthlings is about to answer the question that most troubles our hearts, well, that's a thought that warms our existence and makes it seem better. Isn't that right? Oh, by the way, if you want to follow Webb's aerodynamic situation, position, distance, velocity, etc., step by step, all you have to do is visit this page. See you soon.